Hi everyone, I'm Apoorva Murarka, and I am the winner of this year's graduate winner in the Use It category. And I actually work on using nanomembranes, which are very thin membranes for making transducers that produce sound. But before I jump into that, a little bit about myself. I am a graduate student here pursuing a PhD in electrical engineering and computer science in the Department of Electrical Engineering and Computer Science at MIT. And I actually work on tiny little machines. You might have heard them, sensors and actuators. You can find a little bit of some of them in your phones right now, like accelerometers and gyroscopes. And commonly, they're called micro-electromechanical systems, or MEMS. And the way I came to work on this, believe it or not, was my interest in this field was sort of started when I was in high school and I encountered electricity and magnetism in my physics courses. And at that time, I used to play a lot of video games. And this is before the time Nintendo had the Wii controller or Microsoft had the Kinect. So controllers back in the day, we'd have like 4 or 8 buttons on them and a bunch of joysticks. And you would input your actions into a virtual environment in a very limited manner. And I was like, OK, there's got to be a better, more fluid way to interact with the virtual environment. So that sort of got me talking to people. And they said, hey, you should look into these tiny little machines that are slowly becoming cheaper and cheaper, i.e. accelerometers and gyroscopes. And then I pursued that interest a little bit and sort of did research on that when I got here at MIT in undergrad, and then continued that formally as a grad student here as well. And after that, I worked on a couple of MEMS projects and sort of realized that different people have different ways to how they approach inventing and creating things. But some common themes I've identified in working with a lot of these projects is basically it helps you be curious and observant. If you're curious about something, go observe it. And while you're observing, be even more curious. And they go hand in hand. It can help you do a lot of things. One is identify things that are not working as well as they should be, things that are not broken, but can be made better, and things that are broken that can be fixed. So it helps you identify problems or pain points. At the same time, this process can also hint at solutions. It can help you find solutions to the problems you're trying to solve. Often the people call it inspiration. And beyond that, it's good to have a good tool set to solve problems with. So, and that you can improve your tool set by acquiring knowledge, read widely in fields that you're not even interested in because you don't know what might interest you. So go into different fields, read widely, interact with people in those fields, talk to them about what problems they have, and see if you can try and solve those just as a mental exercise. And beyond that, it's also really, really good to have good mentors who are vested in you. And these mentors will actually supplement that knowledge with their knowledge and their experience and provide the critical feedback that's needed to make sure you're successful in what you do. So now let's move into the current talk of the current project that I'm working on, which is generating sounds from electrical signals. So if you were to take apart your tablet or your cell phone or your earphone, I think this making the sound in there is essentially a microspeaker, and that consists of essentially 3 or 4 common things. One is a magnet, and the second thing is this winding of a metal wire around the magnet. It's called a voice coil, and that coil is attached to a diaphragm. And when an electrical signal flows through the coil, what happens is there's a magnetic force generated on the coil vibrates, and as the coil vibrates, the diaphragm that is attached to the coil will also move, and as the diaphragm moves back and forth, it pushes the air in front, and you hear sound. Unfortunately, what happens is when the current is actually flowing through the coil, it encounters resistance, so it's almost like how you encounter friction when you're walking, and that resistance causes heat to be produced. And what happens is that heat is actually lost. You cannot recover it back. So in portable devices, battery life is important. And if you're losing some of that power, in fact, a lot of power, to just irrecoverable heat, unrecoverable heat, can we do better? So what I came up with as part of my research at MIT was a capacitive structure, a structure that consists of two electrically conducting layers. One is a flexible layer, which is a membrane that is only about 100 nanometers thick. We can even make it thinner. And that is separated from a second electrode, a silicon electrode, with a insulating material, such as silicon dioxide, which is glass. And what we do is we pattern the glass with tiny little cavities on the size or order of microns. And that allows the compliant or the flexible gold nanomembrane to deflect into the cavities when I apply any type of force onto it. So it can be a sound pressure, or in reverse, I can apply an electrical signal and cause electrical force to cause the membrane to deflect. So this membrane, so if you look under the microscope, we can actually scale the size of the membrane. So one such device over here, each of those sides is about a millimeter wide, and the whole membrane covers about 1,000 cavities. And we can scale the size of the membrane to suit different applications. And when we apply a voltage or electrical signal between the top electrode and the bottom electrode, the two electrically conducting electrodes, what happens is you actually start to get an electric field or electric force acting on the membrane. And because your nanomembrane is actually flexible, it starts to deflect like a drumhead inside each of those cavities. So as we increase this force, increase the voltage, we're increasing the force, and that increase in the force causes the membrane to deflect even more. So now we know that we can deflect the membrane, but can we deflect it fast enough to make sound? So usually we hear, human beings usually hear between, say, 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz, and most of our human speech and music content is between about 100 hertz to about 8 kilohertz. So can we vibrate these membranes fast enough? So what we did was we went ahead and applied a time-varying voltage. So here we're actually vibrating the membranes about 1,000 times per second. So we actually slowed down this video so you can see just one cycle of deflection. And as the gold membrane deflects, it goes down by about 100 to 125 nanometers in the center of each of those cavities. And so by actually eliminating the magnet and the voice coil, we take away the heating losses, we increase the battery life, potentially the battery life of many portable devices. And on top of that, compared to an electrodynamic or the magnetic speakers that I was talking about, if you look at the frequency response, which is basically how uniform does it produce the sound across the different rates of driving it, you'll notice that it's not very uniform. This is something you can buy off the shelf, and you'll notice that, you know, it produces more sound at certain frequencies and less sound at other frequencies. So the sound that is produced in the end by the speaker is not as it was intended or as it was recorded. So to increase that truthfulness of the sound that's produced by the speaker, you want the frequency response to be as uniform or as flat as possible. And with this membrane, because it's so tiny, it's so thin, we're actually able to get a much better, flatter frequency response in the range where you actually hear most of human sound and music. Speech and music. So now that we have a better performing speaker, we can also increase the size of these membranes and print multiple of these on the same substrate to increase the sound pressure level and also to get directional sound sources. And these can actually be applied to a lot of different applications, but because of the fact that we're actually getting better sound quality and better better power consumption figures, i.e. longer battery life, one of the applications we're looking at is hearing aids, because they're even a small increase in the battery life can actually make a big difference in the quality of life for the hearing aid user. Beyond just hearing aids and acoustic generation, we're also looking at other applications. So we have demonstrated the use of these membranes for making flexible pressure sensors over large areas, and even using these membranes as mirrors that can move by nanometers, so along about a quarter of the wavelength of light, to make lasers that can change the frequency or the color at which they emit the light. And we're also looking at using these membranes as low voltage transducers for making ultrasound in portable applications such as point of care diagnostics. And with that, I would like to actually thank a lot of this work would not have been possible without guidance from my own mentors. So I would like to thank my PhD advisors, Professor Vladimir Vlovich, Professor Jeffrey Lang, and my collaborators at Bose, Dr. Ole Nielsen. My lab mates at the Organic and Nanostructured Electronics Lab, and of course, the Lemelson Foundation and Lemelson-MIT for this great opportunity and rewarding experience. I'll be happy to take any questions.
Okay. Thank you. We have 1 minute if anyone has a question. Looks like we have one in the center up here.
How big could you possibly make this? How scalable is it?
Right, so right now we have been focusing on getting the area up. So we have gone up to about 4 millimeters to 10 millimeters. So the application space there is still limited to smaller volumes of air. But if you can print these over, say, large areas, say like 10 millimeters or beyond that, so an inch of a wafer, so you could essentially start approaching. But we haven't gone there yet. That's the scalability issue that we're actually exploring, how to make it bigger, a larger area.
Thank you, Apoorva. We're going to move on now to Jessica from Tactile.